Hi there, I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm the director of Kissimmee Park Observatory. In this Star Hopping Extra, we're going to learn about the different types of nebulae, colorful collections of gas and dust that are associated with different stages in the lives of stars. We'll discuss the differences between them and how they might appear in your telescope's eyepiece. More after all this great stuff right after this. Stay tuned. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 27 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm just hysterical to be your host. In this series of programs, we'll show you the most beautiful sights in the night sky and explain exactly how to find them with your binoculars or your telescope. So tonight we're going to discuss the different types of nebulae that you might encounter during your observing sessions. Deep sky objects are generally classified in three main types: galaxies, star clusters, and nebulae. We've already covered the first two in previous Star Hopping Extras, so all we have left to do is nebulae. If you are wondering, nebulae is the plural of nebula. I've used that term several times throughout the episodes of Star Hopping, but I don't think I ever actually explained it. From the Latin, it means little cloud or mist. Nebulae appear differently based on the associated stars that they have within them or associated with them. Very often, the specific stage of life of the associated stars determines the makeup of the nebula. So what are the different types of nebulae? There's five major types, and they are: 1, emission nebula; 2, reflection nebula; 3, dark nebula; 4, planetary nebula; and 5, supernova remnants. The first two, emission and reflection nebulae, are associated generally with younger stars, just getting started in their lives. The last two types, planetary nebula and supernova remnants, are generally associated with the deaths of massive stars and the wreckage left after they tear themselves apart. So let's go in chronological order from the star's perspective and discuss nebulae associated with stellar nurseries and younger stars. And the first is my favorite, emission nebula. Emission nebulae are generally some of the most spectacular objects in the sky because they're misty and colorful in images and are very often full of bright stars. They're also called H2 regions due to the large amount of molecular hydrogen found within them. The gas in these nebulae is excited by the exposure to the energy of the stars within them. It actually begins to glow and emit its own light, hence the name emission nebula. Arguably, the most famous emission nebula is the Great Nebula in Orion, Messier 42. Tucked in the very center of this incredible nebula are five small but very bright stars called the Trapezium, also known as Theta 1 Orionis. I love to describe these to kids at our observing sessions as baby stars. Essentially, they are, because this group of stellar beacons have just recently turned on in a big way, born out of the dense gas and dust that comprises the center of M42. The brightest member of the Trapezium is known to be 250,000 times more luminous than our Sun. This group together lights up the whole center of M42. There are dozens of other examples we've already discussed here on Star Hopping. Some great examples are the Lagoon Nebula, Messier 8, which has a young open star cluster contained within it. Also, the Eagle or Star Queen Nebula, Messier 16, known for the famous Pillars of Creation, has many stellar cocoons, also known as Bach globules, which contains prenatal baby stars that have not yet ignited. A huge emission nebula is the North American Nebula in Cygnus, cataloged as NGC 7000. This massive nebula spans several degrees in the sky and is located near the bright star Deneb, one of the corners of the summer triangle that we learned about in episode 3 of Star Hopping. Another amazing nebula that's a stellar nursery is the famous Rosette Nebula in Monoceros. Again, this nebula is loaded with stars, having an open cluster contained within its gas and dust. Well, as much as I hate to move on, we have four more types of nebulae to cover. So, the second type of nebula on our list is the reflection nebula. This type of object is often positioned behind a star cluster from our perspective. The nebula reflects the light from the nearby stars and assumes the color of these stars. Unlike emission nebula, the gas and reflection nebula does not emit any light itself. One of the most famous examples of a reflection nebula is Messier 45, the Pleiades. The gas nearby these bright hot blue stars picks up the color and reflects that light color back to us, making the entire nebula appear blue. Another great example of reflection nebula is the Witch Head Nebula in Orion. I always thought this one was spooky looking. This is a faint nebula and is difficult to capture. Another beautiful reflection nebula is NGC 1999, also in Orion, captured by the Hubble Space Telescope. Reflection nebulae and emission nebulae are often seen together and are sometimes both referred to as diffuse nebula. The great example of this combination is the famous Trifid Nebula in Sagittarius. The third type of nebulae that we'll be talking about is dark nebulae. The name itself sounds pretty ominous, doesn't it? Essentially, one would never see a dark nebula by itself, but it's usually recognized when it's placed in front of an emission nebula. A dark nebula is very dense in that it completely blocks the light coming from behind it. The most famous dark nebula is the Horsehead Nebula, cataloged as Barnard 33. This amazing inky nebula lies just below the bright star Alnitak, the lowest and leftmost star in the belt of Orion. The dark nebula extends in front of the H2 emission nebula IC434, and it takes the form of a horse's head from our perspective from Earth. Now we move into a more sad topic, nebulae that are created at the end of a star's life. Depending on how massive a star is dictates what mark it makes on the cosmos when it expels most of its stellar material into the surrounding space. If it's a red giant star and it has run out of its nuclear fuel that provides enough internal pressure to hold up its outer shell, the star contracts, and at a certain point it blows out the majority of its ionized gas into a bubble that surrounds what's left of it, now only a white dwarf. Just like a soap bubble, light is caught by the outer layer of that bubble, and from our perspective, it looks like a smoke ring. This is known as a planetary nebula because it can easily be mistaken for a planet in the eyepiece. The most famous example of a smoke ring planetary nebula is the amazing ring nebula in Lyra, Messier 57. If you look closely at this image, you can see the tiny white dwarf star in the center. This actually can be seen in amateur telescopes if you have enough aperture, probably around 10 inches of mirror is needed. Another amazing planetary is the famous Dumbbell Nebula, Messier 27, in the constellations Vulpecula. And the list goes on. A huge planetary nebula lying in the constellations of Aquarius is the Helix Nebula. There's tons of other great examples of great planetary nebula out there. Now, if a star is 8 to 10 times the mass of our Sun, when it runs out of its nuclear fuel, it catastrophically destroys itself in a titanic explosion called a supernova. What's left behind is a nebula called a supernova remnant. There's been only 3 supernovas seen in the Milky Way galaxy, but we see them reasonably often in other galaxies. In this image of the Cigar Galaxy, M82, taken at KPO, we can see the supernova. During the period of maximum brightness, a supernova can outshine the entire galaxy containing it. A supernova remnant will have no specific shape, basically whatever pattern or material it forms after the huge explosion. There are 2 excellent examples of supernova remnants. The most famous is the Crab Nebula, Messier 1 in Taurus. The star that left this wreckage in space exploded in the year 1054, and it was documented by Chinese astronomers in that year. Just 1,000 years ago. Amazing. Another great example is the Veil Nebula in Cygnus. This celestial train wreck was created about 8,000 years ago. This is also called the Filamentary Nebula because of the delicate lines and ribbons of material that's strewn throughout the area. There's an entire loop, and it's fun to move your telescope around to follow it. The 2 main loops are the Eastern and the Western Veil. The Western Veil passes through the bright star 52 Cygni, as shown in this image from KPO. This whole complex is categorized as 5 distinct NGC catalog entries. So let's review the 5 main types of nebulae we discussed. First, we discussed emission nebula, which are energized by the stars within them and they give off their own light. This type of nebula is represented by some of the most beautiful deep sky objects in the sky. Secondly, we talked about reflection nebula, which don't give off any light by themselves, but they reflect the light from the nearby stars. Third, we discussed dark nebulae, which are so dense that they obscure the light from the emission nebula lying behind them. Then we discuss the two types of nebulae that are created upon the deaths of large stars, with red giants less than about 8 solar masses blowing out a bubble of gas known as a planetary nebula. If the star is greater than about 10 solar masses, it ends its life in a titanic explosion and leaves behind a supernova remnant. Pretty amazing, huh? Nebulae are really my most favorite type of deep sky object to photograph because they end up being beautiful and colorful images. But I like galaxies a lot too. So that does it for this week's episode. You can find the show notes on our website at kpobservatory.org/SH027, where you can comment and leave any questions that you may have. Thanks for joining us, and I'll see you next week on our episode of Star Hopping.
I'm Cassie, and I hope you've enjoyed star hopping around the Milky Way. We'll continue to bring you these video astronomy tutorials every week on Thursday, and in their podcast format on Fridays. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them on the internet. The reason we create these videos and podcasts is to help beginning amateur astronomers learn the sky and get more enjoyment out of their telescopes and astronomy in general. If you have any requests for potential targets in the night sky that you would like to see us discuss, just let us know down in the comments section below or on our website blog. Don't miss our free field notes for this episode, basically the script of the show, with all the images and star charts we use for our star hopping activities. You can get them for free at kpobservatory.org/fieldnotes. If this is the first time you're checking out star hopping, and if you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel by clicking the big yellow button, click the thumbs up on the video, and please share this tutorial out to your friends who like looking at stars. Also, as I just mentioned, please feel free to leave any question or comment below, and we'll be sure to respond quickly. Please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astronomical digital images, and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these places in cyberspace, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value, and if you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a small amount per video, you can support our efforts, and help us make even more great astronomy tutorials, just like this one. So bye for now, and thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.